Imagine this, a predator from the last ice age once roaming the plains of North America, potentially walking among us again, thanks to breakthroughs in genetic science. We're talking about the direwolf, a legendary hunter from a forgotten age. But before we leap into what the future might hold, let's take a step back and uncover who the direwolf really was and why it was so different from the wolves we know today. At first glance, it's easy to assume that direwolves and modern gray wolves were close cousins. After all, they share a similar look, large canids with powerful bills and sharp teeth. But beneath the surface, the two species diverged in striking ways. A major study published in 2021, analyzing ancient DNA from fossil remains, revealed something surprising. Direwolves and gray wolves haven't shared a common ancestor for roughly 5.7 million years. That's more than enough time for them to evolve along completely separate paths, developing different traits, behaviors, and genetic signatures. This study reshaped our understanding of the canid family tree. It wasn't just a small divergence, it was a complete evolutionary fork. Direwolves represented a lineage that thrived independently for millions of years, adapting to the unique challenges of prehistoric North America. In fact, their isolation was so complete that no genetic mixing occurred between them and the incoming Eurasian canids, even when their ranges overlapped for thousands of years. That kind of genetic separation over such a long period is rare in closely related carnivores. Despite sharing the continent during the Ice Age and likely competing for similar prey, these two species were genetically incompatible. Unlike gray wolves and coyotes, which often interbreed, even today, direwolves were isolated in their own evolutionary lane. Gray wolves and their relatives hail from Eurasia and arrived in the Americas relatively recently. Direwolves, meanwhile, evolved solely in North America, occupying that land long before their Eurasian cousins made the journey across the Bering Land Bridge. Even their scientific classifications reflect this difference. Gray wolves are members of the genus Canis, alongside coyotes, jackals, and domestic dogs. Direwolves, by contrast, are placed in a separate genus altogether, Anosion, which means terrible wolf. And that name wasn't just for show, it reflects the fearsome capabilities they had as top predators. Direwolves were physically formidable, not the exaggerated monsters depicted in TV shows, but still larger and more powerful than most modern wolves. They typically weighed between 60 to 70 kilograms, around 130 to 150 pounds, which puts them on par with the largest gray wolves alive today, like those found in Alaska or Canada. But the build was different. Direwolves were stockier, with shorter, thicker legs, more robust frames, and denser bones. Think of a wolf that trained as a heavyweight fighter, broad-chested, muscular, and built for brawling. This physicality had a purpose. Direwolves weren't chasing prey across vast distances. Their design was better suited for ambushing and overpowering large, powerful animals. They weren't runners, they were wrestlers. Gray wolves, by comparison, are marathoners. Sleeker and longer-legged, a typical gray wolf weighs 100 to 110 pounds and relies on stamina, not brute force. They track prey over long distances, testing for weakness before moving in. The skull of the direwolf told another story of specialization. Their heads were wider, with thick snouts and reinforced bones designed to handle immense stress. The jaw structure featured massive zygomatic arches, anchoring powerful muscles for crushing bites. It's estimated that the bite force at their canines exceeded 1,300 newtons, making it the strongest known bite among canids. That's not just enough to kill, it's enough to break through bone. Their teeth, too, were sturdier and more resistant to fracture, more reminiscent of hyenas than modern wolves. Fossils show heavy tooth wear and even breakage, suggesting these animals regularly crunched through bones to reach the marrow. Meanwhile, gray wolves have narrower snouts and sharper teeth, designed for slicing and precision. Their jaws are powerful, no doubt, enough to bring down large prey like moose, but they're adapted for versatility, not sheer crushing power. The Ice Age ecosystem favored the direwolf style. North America was a land of giants, towering mammoths, colossal bison, ancient horses, and even massive ground sloths. Direwolves thrived in this high-calorie environment, hunting or scavenging from animals that sometimes outweighed them tenfold. Isotope analyses of their bones confirm a diet heavily based on large mammals. They weren't picky about species, just the size. But this specialization came at a price. As the Ice Age drew to a close around 12,000 years ago, that world of giants vanished. Climate change and the arrival of human hunters led to the extinction of many megafauna species. And with their primary food sources gone, direwolves faced an existential crisis. Their powerful bodies required enormous energy to maintain, and smaller animals like deer or rabbits just weren't enough to sustain them. Gray wolves, however, survived. And not just survived, they thrived. Their ability to shift diets, territories, and behaviors meant they could adapt to a changing world. Whether it was large game, small mammals, fish, or even fruit, gray wolves took whatever they could find. Their flexibility was their superpower. It wasn't just about food. Gray wolves had other advantages too. For one, they could interbreed with coyotes and even early domesticated dogs, allowing for genetic exchanges that may have helped them deal with disease and environmental stress. Direwolves were isolated genetically. That might have left them more vulnerable to illness, especially as humans and their animals moved into the landscape. There's also the social side. Both direwolves and gray wolves were social pack animals. But how do we know that about a creature extinct for thousands of years? For one, their fossils show very low sexual dimorphism. Males and females were similarly sized, a trait that in living species often correlates with monogamy and strong pack bonds. They likely lived in structured groups led by a dominant breeding pair, much like today's wolves. And then there's the La Brea tar pits in California. These sticky death traps have yielded hundreds of direwolf fossils, many found clustered together. That suggests they hunted or scavenged in groups, drawn to the scent of trapped animals and willing to take collective risks for a potential meal. A lone predator might have stayed away, but packs made it worthwhile and helped fend off rival carnivores like saber-toothed cats or giant lions. While we can't directly observe their behavior, it's likely direwolves coordinated during hunts, communicated vocally, and maintained strong bonds. In short, they were probably clever, loyal, and cooperative, just like their modern cousins. But again, adaptability was the key. Gray wolves can vary pack size based on territory and prey. If resources are low, they hunt in pairs. If chasing big game, they gather the full squad. Direwolves may not have had that same flexibility. Their entire strategy relied on consistency. Large prey, large packs, large meals. Once those prey disappeared, their social model may have collapsed. A lone direwolf wasn't just alone, it was functionally doomed. Fast forward to today, and scientists are once again turning their attention to this Ice Age legend. In late 2024, a biotech company called Colossal Biosciences revealed something extraordinary. They had successfully engineered pups with direwolf-like traits. Not through cloning, but by selectively editing 20 genes in gray wolf embryos, genes linked to size, skull shape, fur thickness, and muscular development, based on ancient DNA samples extracted from fossilized teeth, one dating back 13,000 years. The result? Three pups named Romulus, Remus, and Kessie. Early reports show broader heads, chunkier frames, and thicker coats. Physical echoes of the direwolf form. These young canids are being raised under careful observation in a protected reserve, with ethical oversight that includes guidance from indigenous communities. But here's the caveat. While the achievement is remarkable, many researchers caution that this isn't true resurrection. Editing a couple dozen genes only scratches the surface of the tens of thousands that made direwolves unique. Genetically, these animals are still mostly gray wolf, over 99% so. What Colossal has done is offer a proof of concept, a way of demonstrating that we can begin to shape living animals toward extinct archetypes. It's part of a broader vision. Colossal is also working on bringing back the woolly mammoth and the dodo bird, aiming to restore lost ecological roles. These aren't just nostalgic experiments, they're attempts to reintroduce balance to ecosystems that have never fully recovered from past extinctions. The implications go beyond science fiction. Reviving extinct traits could one day help us engineer more resilient species, rewild fragile ecosystems, or even understand how extinction events unfolded in the first place. But with great power comes great responsibility. There are ethical questions. What happens if these re-engineered predators thrive too well? Where will they live? What impact will they have? So, will the direwolf walk the earth again? Not quite. But for the first time in over 10,000 years, a piece of its legacy may be alive in flesh and fur. Whether that leads to a true revival or remains a scientific footnote, only time and technology will tell. Thanks for watching. If this journey through the Ice Age and beyond fascinated you, don't forget to like, subscribe, and drop a comment below. Let us know which prehistoric creature you'd like us to explore next. Until then, stay curious.